Praise God. I like how a sister is putting her talents and laying them at God's feet. You know, so many of us have talents, but we use them for ourselves. And I think it's common that we see like a brother up here holding a guitar or playing on a keyboard, and we say, man, if I only could play the keyboard, if I could only play the guitar, and we think that's the only way that we can serve God with our talents. That's the only talent that God can capitalize on. But if we wake up every morning and we say, Lord, use me. Sometimes it'll be with that person that you speak to every day that maybe looks up to you, maybe they're about this tall. And your talent may not be visible to you, but if you put your heart in God's hands and say, Lord, use me, He'll use you. And He'll show you what your talents are and how He's using them. Like Andy said last week, I haven't taught from a book before, you know, especially here in church. Usually my inspiration to teach here is the Bible, God's Word. Right? So it's kind of a shift change for me. But praise God that this book is Bible-inspired. And its foundation, a lot of it is in the book of Acts. Because it's kind of the direction for the model for Calvary Chapels throughout. And if you haven't had a chance to read it, I encourage you to pick one up. They're pretty cheap. If you, like me, live in the digital age and you want some of a digital copy, you can download it for free. I did. If you want something physical to hold on to, I know some people like the actual book, hard print. They're about $5 to $10. You can find them for as cheap as like $5. But it's an easy read. I think it's written to like the lowest common denominator, so you don't have to pick up a dictionary to understand what each word means. It's a pretty simple, easy read. And the value of it is the foundation for Calvary Chapels. Its application, its foundations, it talks about the government of Calvary Chapels throughout. So if you've ever thought of why this, why that, and you pick this up and you read it, you'll understand the why. Some things you may agree with, some things you may not. When you go to the Word and God reveals to you what, why and how, you understand. We're called to do that. How many people know that God tells us to listen to everyone and go to the words, go to God's Word, to the Bible, and weigh it against what He says and see if it's based. There was a group of people called Bereans, again from the book of Acts, that Paul said, you know, these people are pretty good because they listen to people. They don't just dismiss them. This one common belief in every educational system is if you think you already have the truth and you don't listen to what people have to say, then you're already dismissing the possibility of enhancing your knowledge. And the Apostle Paul said that. Obviously not in those words, but he said that the Bereans were good and that they listened to everybody, right? And they weighed what they said against the scriptures. And that's what we're called to do. So I'm going to ask you, if you brought your sword, if you brought your Bible, open up to Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6, okay? And this teaching, if nothing else, is to call us to search the scriptures, to study them. The book of Acts is a lot of what this is based on. But the Proverbs were written by who?
Son of Solomon.
Right. And what does the Bible say about that guy?
He's wise.
He was one of the wisest people, right? I say one of. At that point, it said that he was the wisest person. Then Christ came, and I think that was not the boy, right? But I say one of the wisest people. And it says here, and this is somebody that amassed the most amount of wealth on earth. That's what the Bible says, right? Someone that had, as far as possessions and knowledge, some the most. And it says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not on your money, right? Lean on in your certificates and your degrees and your PhDs. It says, lean on to thine heart, thy own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge your counselor, your husband, no, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. How important is that? So let's pray. Dear God, we thank you, Lord, because it's you that gives wisdom. It's you, Lord, that comforts a heart that nobody else can. It's you, Lord, that teaches the wise. And it's you, Lord, that calls yourself the husband to the widow and the father to the fatherless. I pray, Lord, that it be you that speaks to your people. In Jesus' name, Lord, I place my heart, my mouth, and my time, Lord. Amen. So if we want to build a good church, we can go to many sources, right? But if we want to build the perfect church, the bride of Christ, we need to go to His Word. We need to seek His understanding. We need to seek His counsel. Rick Warren wrote something that I wanted to quote. It's pretty interesting what he said. He says, "The Constitution is man-made, so it's not perfect. It's not the basis of my beliefs. My belief system is based on the scriptures, which come from God." Each one of us has a basic belief systems. Many of us, and I include myself, at one point or another, based on my experiences, my childhood, my wife, my girlfriend, my boyfriend, and our belief systems every day when you wake up are based on that. I'm having a terrible day because this happened to me, right? I have this grudge against my dad because he did this to me, and I'm not talking to him, right? And our belief systems are based on our experiences, right? How many of us can say that my everyday belief systems are based on God's promises to me? And it's a rhetorical question. I'm not asking you to tell me. I'm asking you to seek in your heart and analyze where you're at. And if you can honestly say, I believe in the promise that God made me. And every day, regardless of what someone did to me, regardless of what someone said to me, I'm trusting in Him. Can you say that? And I don't ask you to say it to me, but analyze yourself. Because the Bible tells us to analyze yourself, right? And Rick can say that my belief system is based on God's Word. In this chapter, what we're going to be working on or studying is going to be the building the church God's way, right? And again, a lot of it is based on the book of Acts. And the first verse that Chuck Smith goes to is Zechariah 4:6. So I'm going to ask if you can, again, open your Bible, and we're going to go to Zechariah 4:6. Now, just to give you a little, while you guys are looking at Zechariah 4:6, a little bit about it. This book was written after captivity during the rebuilding of the temple, right? So the book of Zechariah is about redemption, right? The nation of Israel was under captivity, under King Darius's rule, right? So think of a big ruler which had a large area that he had under his control. And he allowed for the people of Israel to go back and rebuild the temple, right? And Zechariah is sending this message to the governor of Judah, Zerubbabel, is that how you pronounce his name? Yeah. And to the high priest. And by the way, the high priest was not doing what he was supposed to, but he was the high priest, right? And Zechariah's job is to go tell the governor, right, the big guy, the guy in charge, this. And mind you, they're rebuilding the temple, right? And during the time where they're under rule from somebody else. And just to give you a little background, he's the messenger that's going to deliver this message. Okay. So it says, so he answered and said to me, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts." I don't think they wanted to hear that. Amen? You'd think, let's go throw down. Let's build up the armies and, let's defeat these guys. Right? That's the first thing that comes to mind. But God says, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. Many times, In a church, you think, man, it's about the worship, right? We get just a glimpse of God's glory in worship. And I know myself, man, I want to pound on that drum as hard as I can because I'm thinking God's going to hear me, you know? But he's hearing me when I'm driving to work. You know, when someone cuts me off and I get upset at them and I want to do something to them, he's hearing that. You know? When I'm driving to church and I get mad because somebody cut me off, he's hearing me then. You know, not when I'm here. Of course he's hearing me here. But see, worship doesn't start here. It starts at home. It starts when you're alone. That's worship. And God says, by his Spirit. Amen. That's the beauty of building the church, by his Spirit. See, many, many places out there have and follow trends, right? I don't know if you guys are aware of this. I learned this a while back. But there's actually some brothers out there that believe that if you can handle a deadly snake and it bites you and you don't die, then you're right with God. You know? Because there's a recorded instance in the Bible, right, of a brother, Paul, that goes to an island and he gets bitten and he doesn't die by a deadly serpent. So clearly, if you're able to withstand the bite of a deadly snake, you know, you're right with God. That's a trend. That's not biblical. It's important that we're grounded and rooted and not follow a lot of the trends. I don't want to quote or call anybody out because it's God's will. It's God's power to make them right. And I don't want to be pointing other brothers' flaws in gospels that they're trying to spread the word. But there's a lot of preachers out there that have drenched God's scripture with self-help principles. And you hear their messages if you follow them on Facebook and, you know, the power within you and, you know, all these things. That's not the power of God's word. That's mixing man's philosophies with his word. And that's why it's so important that we as Bereans weigh what people tell you with God's word. That we analyze the scriptures and see what they're telling us. I just learned last week that a church out there is actually doing a yoga chant through the service. And I thought, wow. You know, the book of Revelation warns us that some of the stuff's going to be going on, you know. But if we don't look for them, then we're going to be deceived. Because the Bible says even the very elect will be deceived, could be deceived, right? But if you're in your word, seeking the Lord's will for the church, and he's giving you the signs of the time in here, and you know what those are, you won't be swayed. Because, you know, the Bible says that not to sway to the right, nor to the left. Many of us are aware about the left. Some of us aren't looking to the right. You know? It tells us about both directions, and I wonder why. Have you ever wondered why? Because if the Bible says to the right or to the left, it's for a reason. The other one is sometimes we go too extreme where we feel that, I come from a Pentecostal upbringing, and I love my Pentecostal brothers. I love them. I love the worship, the Pentecostal Spanish worship. That's a church I came from, very small, and it came from a congregational role. We'll touch a little bit on God's government, the church's government, but sometimes in that fellowship that I grew up in, if you didn't speak in tongues, then you weren't really born again. You weren't really saved. You know, you were missing something. And the same was true. You know, if you didn't have the liberty to dance, then, you know, you don't have that freedom of God's Spirit, you know. And as I study the scriptures, it tells me otherwise. It tells me that love is more important than all these other things, you know. And that if I don't have love, even though I can speak in tongues, even though I may dance on top of the table and jump from table to table, it means nothing, you know. And God will show you what that love is and what those fruits are. And if you don't have any fruit, then what's going to happen to you? Because the Bible says that the tree that bears no fruit is going to be what?
Cut down.
So I should be ready to have God's love in my heart. The focal points Calvary Chapel distinctives, and there's some that really stand out to me. They're loud. The one that last week was really loud, and I love how Andy was mentioning the priority of the word, right? But one of them, it is obviously the model for the church, which if we go through the book of Acts, it's really loud. It's really loud. I don't know, has anyone here had the opportunity to study the book of Acts from beginning to end? And I don't mean to read, because I was mentioning this earlier with Brother Richard. You know, sometimes when we read something, and I get this, even with the book of Psalms, we read poetry or we read a famous quote for somebody, and we say, oh, that was pretty cool, you know. And it's pretty cool to read something. But then when you study it, you say, you know what, this guy is a creationist. This guy is an atheist. As you study their mindset of why they wrote that and where they were coming from. And you know, even the book of Psalms, a lot of it is poetry and songs. But if you study it, instead of just reading it, you say, wow, this is revelation right here. This is actually telling me about something else. This is more than just a song. And as you analyze, you realize, oh, wow, this is prophetic. You know? And I ask, because if you study the book of Acts, there's so much there. It's not even written by the Apostle Paul, but it's written by Luke, right? And like many people believe that it's just to give an account of what the Apostle Paul did. Other people believe that it's just about the Holy Spirit, right? Other people, and this is a lot of theologists believe that, oh, that this book was written by Luke in defense to the Apostle Paul as he's going to Rome, because these letters are going ahead of him as he's going to arrive. That may be true. I believe this is what God's revealed. That's God's plan for the church. You know? And he's giving us the blueprint of what we're to do. In the concept of church government, there's three forms. I'm just going to touch a little bit because as we move along through the study of the book, of the distinctives, other brothers are going to touch more and more and go more in depth. But the building of the church God's way is really important to have the government as God ordains and let him rule over the church, not us. Sometimes we have some pretty cool titles, you know, the reverend, or, you know, the bishop, or the pastor. The Bible says that when we get to heaven, we're going to toss our crowns. Our crowns. You know, that's the physical embodiment of authority of anybody that has power, right? So if you're a king, depending on how much bling you have on your crown, that's how much authority, how much wealth you have. Well, that we're going to toss at the feet of Christ. So what does a title mean? Nothing. His title is the one that endures. But, you know, there's three basic forms of government, church government. There's a bishop, right? And it's basically one person that oversees a group, a church. And in 1 Timothy 3, 2 through 7, you don't have to read it, but if you're taking notes, write this down, because it goes into detail of what a bishop is and isn't supposed to do, and what the call is for that. Now, I think it's interesting that many, many folks that have been in authority in churches, famous churches, that have made mistakes, because you know what? Believe it or not, they're human, right? They were in that one position, and the Lord attacks leaders. This is common practice, very common. I don't care what kind of organization you're in, but if you're in some type of warfare, you go after the leader, you knock the organization down. It's basic math. It works everywhere. Why do you think we have a secret service? Because we need the nation to function correctly, right? If they whack the president, guess what? There goes a lot of the perception of our foes of our country. The same is true in the church. There's basic functions that the leader of the church is to have. I personally, now this isn't something I read, but this is a personal opinion. When you set up a government rule of the church as a bishop, you have a single point of failure. That's just my opinion. It's biblical, because the Bible describes organizations that had a bishop role. But I think it's a single point of failure. The other one is elders, right? And a lot of that we see as early as Moses, right? When Moses was told to get some folks that were like-minded, filled with the Spirit, and have them rule over the distinct tribes, and Moses can then delegate work and responsibilities to them, which is biblical from ancient times. And then there's the third. The third is congregational. Now, this one I'm hard-pressed to find a successful model inside of the Bible. I didn't find any. Maybe you have more luck than I have. But there isn't. As a matter of fact, there are examples to the contrary. Examples of non-successful congregational rule. Whether you go to, you know, the calf, you know, with Moses and the whole dancing and that kind of thing. And if you really study that, a lot of what happened is pretty crazy bad. And then there's the people that murmured, right, against God. That sounds like an oxymoron, you murmur against God. There's another oxymoron in the book of Revelation. People went to a war with God. But those are constant examples of congregational rule that is not biblically positive. Again, going back to other churches that I've attended, when you have a congregational rule, the rule of the majority of rules, I don't know if you've heard that saying, but it can go anyway. There's no structure. Now, in the book of Acts, it speaks of positive elder rule in 14:23, right? Where to have men that are filled with God's Spirit and have them make decisions and seek the Lord's will in prayer. But if we're not doing that as a congregational rule, I've actually seen folks that do a congregational elections. Hands go up and the majority rule takes it. That's cool if everyone is seeking the Lord's will. Is that really what the Bible says? It says that the narrow path is the one that leads to the Lord, right? So how can that be? You know, if you seek the confirmation biblically, it's really hard-pressed to find congregational rule that's aligned with God's will. How do we know God's way? You know, and the way that we do is by seeking His word. You know, David said, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet." Right? I'm going to read a couple of paragraphs of this book. And it's the first couple of paragraphs. I think they're pretty loud. A couple of things about the chapter of Building the Church God's Way. I heard the saying, if it's God's will, it's God's bill. Right? I don't know if you guys have ever heard that. And many times we say, oh, you know what, the Lord's put this in my heart. I don't know how I'm going to do it. I don't know what's going to happen. But if you seek Him, and He'll show you. You know, I know of a sister that she's got special needs, right? She's traveled to many places where most people that have a higher IQ than her, have a better education than her, and are highly employed that she is not, have never even visited. But God sent her as a missionary to teach and work at places that most of us would never dream of even visiting, and God's blessed her. And again, she doesn't have a job. You know, because she believes in her heart that if it's God's will, it's God's will. You know, there's a story in the Bible, and it always trips me out when I read this story. You know, Jesus sent an apostle to go fish, pull out a fish, and there's going to be a coin in his mouth, and he used that as a form of payment. Now, if that's not wacky or weird, you tell me what it is. I mean, not only am I going to go fish, right? How do I get this fish? Because there's a coin in his mouth. But, I mean, you're going to get it, and you're going to use that coin to go pay for something. Wow. Imagine you giving that order to somebody. And what are they going to tell you here? Wow. You know? But that's how God made a way. You know, if you're careful enough to listen to God, He'll direct you in your path that you should go according to His will. But you have to seek His will. See, it says here, in the 39th, for those that do have the book, page 39, it says, another distinctive characteristic of Calvary Chapel is our relaxed, casual style. We don't get involved in a lot of spiritual hype. We don't try to motivate people carnally. We aren't apt to shout at the congregation. I believe this stems from our belief and trust in Jesus Christ and in His Holy Spirit. We are of the belief that if the Lord doesn't build a house, they labor in vain who build it. So all of our hype and pressure aren't really going to do the job. We simply trust in the work of the Holy Spirit and of Jesus Christ, who is building His church as He said He would. That's pretty cool, because if you're a leader and you're in your heart, you know you're doing God's will. You trust that He's bringing who He said He'd bring. He's ministering to those that need to be ministered. His Spirit is reaching those that need to be reached. And you don't have to worry about, man, we got to get some more snakes, because we're out of snakes. we're out of deadly snakes. You only have rattlesnakes. You know? No. It's God's Spirit. He's going to do what He's going to do. You know? He knows what people's hearts need. He's going to provide, you know, that milk for that newborn, that Christian newborn. He's going to provide that wisdom to that elder that's been in the church for 30 plus years and has studied the Bible back and forth 5 times. You know, who's going to teach that brother anything? You know, me, because I went to seminary or have a PhD in theology? I can't, you know, because the Lord reveals, He gives wisdom to the wise, you know. And if we allow Him to be God and rule over His people, then He's going to do just that. The next chapter says, if we have complete confidence that is His church, that it's His church, that He is going to build it, and that He's going to do His job, then all I have to do is be faithful. That's so cool. You know, how many times have we thought, you know, and maybe it's not here, but in a secular job, how can I do my job better? Because I really want to look good in front of the boss, right? How can I do my job better? Because, you know, in 3 months, it's going to be, you know, evaluation time or whatever, you know. But how cool is it that, dude, all I got to do is just be faithful. That's all I got to do. Know that I'm following His will and be faithful. And He's going to increase. He's going to do His thing. That's all I got to do. So there shouldn't be stress and, man, what am I going to do now? You know, I can't change a heart. As much as I try, I can't change anybody's heart. As much as I want to, I can't give words of comfort. You know, as Peter said, only you have the words of life. Since I simply need to watch His work, and then the pressure isn't on me. I don't get all hyped or pressured because the work of God isn't my responsibility. It's not my church. It's His church. I believe that it's very important to remember this, because if you try to carry the load and bear the burden, you'll find that it's too hard for you. You'll find yourself under pressure to create schemes and hypes, and then you begin to push and manipulate people. That isn't the Calvary Chapel style. Later on in the same chapter, Chuck Smith goes into explaining about when his church, he had a problem that I think most pastors would love to have. And some people, you know, think, oh, that's kind of cool, I wish I had that. But he had grown. That his congregation grew really, really large. And for those that don't know, like the story of Pastor Chuck Smith, he started with hippies, you know, and when hippies weren't really trendy, and they were a new thing. But he opened his doors, and he loved on them, and he shared God's word in a language, in a way that they could understand. And believe it or not, his congregation grew and grew and grew, and before you knew it, they had tents outside and speakers outside, and it was just too large to accommodate for where they were fellowshipping. And they didn't have facilities, you know. And through other people, God was showing him how to get the building they needed and the real estate that they needed. But he questioned it, and the way that it was coming, And finally, he let God be God. And I mean, they're blessed. If you've been to their facilities, you see that, wow, this is like by design really nice. But in that chapter, it goes through his emotional roller coaster and him wanting to do it his way and him wanting to get the real estate, the building, the money, and how he thought it should be. And finally he let his guard down and he opened his heart and he said, Lord, this is your church. This is not even my bill. This is your bill. So if this is what you want, then open the doors. And all the doors just opened up. And how cool is it when we're able to do that? Maybe for you, you're not a pastor. Maybe for you, you're not leading a church. But what is it that you haven't rendered onto the Lord? And ask, Lord, what's your will? You know, I want to do this your way. Whether it's with a family member, whether it's at work, whatever it may be. The application of this isn't just for pastors, because we're to seek his will. We're not to lean on our own understanding, you know. And that's probably the biggest takeaway from this is, what areas have I not rendered unto the Lord? You know, that's all the Lord gave me for this chapter. I don't know if there's any questions or anything else.
Thanks, Pastor Hector. Appreciate that. You know, the whole purpose of this, I guess you want to call it anything, call it a series, going to the Calvary Distinctives. Obviously, we are not a Calvary affiliate. We're not a Calvary affiliate. We're a Rhema of Life Church. We're independent. But we are definitely a non-denominational fellowship. It's important that you all, as the congregation, those that come here to get fed every Sunday, that you understand from what perspective the teachings, the mindset, the things that we do or the things that we don't do are coming from. Because it is all purposed and planned as according to God's word. That's what I... That's basically what I have submitted to, is those distinctives. And it's important, too, to understand that it wasn't because someone told me to. You know? No one came up to me and said, hey, if you're going to be a pastor, you need to submit to the Calvary Distinctives. I've read the book myself. I've read a lot of different things about Pastor Chuck and the moving of the Holy Spirit and the whole Calvary movement and so on and so forth. But I've read the Calvary Distinctives myself personally, then did exactly what Pastor Hector was talking about, going to the Word of God for that peace and that verification of the truth as far as how to allow God to build this fellowship. You will see that, you know, the handprint or the fingerprint of God in that manner in regards to the Calvary Distinctives. You know, because every church will ultimately adhere, and that's the word I was looking for, will adhere to some type of church government and that affects all aspects of the church fellowship itself. Whether it's, you know, how, you know, if you have a church project, how you go about that, if you're going to start a new ministry, how you can go about that, if there needs to be some financial decisions, how do you go about that, you know, how do you put people in the leadership and so on and so forth. It has to stem from the Word of God, and it has to be some type of adhering to a teaching. You know, this is not a philosophy. This is an actual teaching that's verifiable. So, like I said, important for you as a fellowship or as you, as those who come and attend the church, and obviously some of you are actually part of the eldership, that you have that understanding. Because, you know, as God continues to, you know, like, for example, I'll give you this as an example. You know, it's easy to fall into the trap of trying to multiply the church. Get numbers, you know. And through our own efforts, you know, I come from a marketing background. I know about marketing. I know about, you know, how to get the pulse on people and so on and so forth. And there's churches that do that, that go out and go into the communities and say, why don't you come to church? And they'll, for example, say, well, you know what? It's just boring. I find it boring. Or, you know, it's not as tantalizing as I like, you know? I want more light, more action. And so they take all this information and they go back to their churches and then they mold the church in that manner. And so that's artificial. That's very artificial. Sure, then all of a sudden they, people start coming. It's like, oh yeah, they got this, they got that, they got a basketball team. They offer, you know, crocheting and all that stuff. Oh man, it's awesome. And it's almost like, you know, a demand of things that they want to see, like it's some kind of country club or something like that. But that's not the church. Because then ultimately what happens is that when that group of people get tired of basketball, guess what? They bounce, no pun intended. There's a we're out of here. You know, we're just not into basketball anymore. You know? And it's artificial. A church needs to be built on the truth of the Word of God and on repentance. Repentance. Jesus told that to the leaders of, you know, to the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He says, you know, if you don't repent, you will die in your sin. Or in other words, hey, you can have all these goodies that you want, all these programs, all this other stuff that you offer up, but if people aren't repenting and coming to the knowledge of salvation, they will die in their sin. You can have thousands of people that come on a weekly basis, and it happens. There's examples of that. There's churches like that today. They get hundreds of people coming every weekend, but they're dying in their sin because there is no repentance. Or the, you know, they're doing it out of habit, or they're doing it out of the offerings that they have, whatever the case may be. But they're just dying in their sins. And so, like I said, you know, this is what this fellowship is all about. We're teaching. You know, Pastor Danny is going to teach next week on
grace upon grace.
Grace upon grace. And again, that's a distinctive. It's a distinctive grace upon grace out of the scriptures. And then the final week, I haven't decided which chapter I'm going to teach on. And then we'll be done with, you know, this kind of like mini-series. But I want to encourage you as well as what Pastor Hector said. Either A, get the book yourself, or get it online and read through it. It will increase your faith and your wisdom and knowledge to be able to share with others as well. Because all these distinctives ultimately point to Jesus as, you know, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the ruler of this fellowship, of this ministry, of our hearts, of everything that we do, or that, like I said, that we don't do. You know, he did touch upon a couple of things in regards to, you know, like, for example, the Pentecostal type of fellowship. You know, you might say, well, why don't we dance around? Well, no one said, you know, that you can't dance around. You just do it after church. You know, do it on your way to church. You know, or whatever the case may be. You know, there may be a special time for that where we have what's called basically you know, seeking the Holy Spirit and what's referred to commonly as an afterglow. An afterglow is specifically a time to come together. We worship, you know, the Lord, and we ask the Holy Spirit to descend upon us and to, you know, to fill us, to renew us, to restore us. There may be opportunities to speak in tongues as long as there's interpretation. And, you know, maybe an opportunity for those that, you know, want to dance before the Lord. Cool, you know, maybe sit in the back, in the back spot and dance upon and show your love to the Lord as King David did. That's all cool. But there's a time and a place for that. And, you know, in the middle of the church there's a dancing bus out. That's not going to happen, you know. That's not God. That's this order. All of a sudden you become the focus and the center of the attraction. We're here to make Jesus the center of everything, of our affection, of our focus, of our worship, of our giving, of our talents, everything. It's all about Jesus, you know? And so, but like I said, I encourage you in that to get the book. So, you know, no questions regarding that? Observations, or maybe some of you have experienced something differently in some of the fellowships that you used to go to before. You know, I did want to touch a little bit regarding congregational, because that's important. You know, he mentioned congregational. Congregational is basically when the congregation makes all the decisions, for the most part. You could see just right off the bat how that could be troubled. And in the sense that, you know, there's a different variation as far as where people are at in their walk with the Lord. And when you have congregational, then, you know, if there's some that are distant from the Lord, they still have a say. You know, and he did cite the example, you know, in regards to the Old Testament there in Exodus, when Moses went away to go get the, you know, the commandments from the Lord and spend time with the Lord, what happened? The congregation came together and decided, hey, you know what? Is he even coming back? You know, he's been gone for a while. We have no leader, you know? So we have a great idea. Let's get together as a congregation and we'll make decisions. And look at the decision that they made. The ultimate was, you know, the golden calf. And Aaron succumbed to that pressure. He succumbed to that pressure of the congregation, and he thought it was a good idea too. And then later on, when Moses came back, Aaron basically threw everyone under the bus, didn't he? He just basically said, well, it was their idea. It's like, well, dude, no, I left you in charge to have a spine and to basically stand for the things of God. This idolatry is definitely not of the Lord. What went wrong here? And they're having orgies in the whole nine yards, you know? It's just crazy. And I'm not saying that would happen here.
Yeah.
You know? But God's order is God, his under-shepherd, the elders, and the congregation. And it's not a militant thing either, because, you know, amongst the congregations, there's desires that come up to say, hey, you know what, pastor, we'd love to be doing this ministry. All right, well, let's pray about it. It sounds biblical. It sounds like you have a passion for it. And tag, you're it. Sounds like the Holy Spirit called you to do it. So get to it, you know? And you go out there and you birth it, you know? And then we come together prayerfully and we pray for that ministry. But it's so important because, like I said, when we don't have that knowledge, then also what happens is the enemy starts sneaking in. He starts saying, oh yeah, your pastor, and I'm not just referring to me, but this fellowship, your pastor, he thinks he's everything. He needs Mr. Know-it-all. And all. I don't know everything. I know a skosh of things. All I know is the most important thing. I seek the Lord. But that's how the enemy comes in and starts putting thoughts into our head that are not biblical, and that's how a fellowship gets torn down. You know, you see that constantly, regretfully, you know, where all of a sudden, you know, there's that murmuring going on and the lies of the enemy get spread. Instead of saying, hey, you know what? What's my responsibility as a member of this fellowship? Biblically, what's my responsibility? Because we all have a responsibility under the Lord. All of us have a responsibility under the Lord. And then you submit to that in love, in obedience unto the Lord. You know? And there's examples of that all through the scriptures, you know. If you got a problem with somebody, you go to Matthew 18, you take that issue to them, they don't want to listen, you take it to the elders, you know. The point is, you go out to do your best to resolve it in love and humility. If it can't be resolved, then you know what? Then you just lay it down, and you keep on loving, but you just got to let it go, you know. Financially, you know, financial decisions, ministerial decision making, so on and so forth. There's rhymes and reasons behind everything. And when we're all connected like that to the main source, which is Christ Jesus, then that's called, you know, serving the Lord in harmony. Or as the Bible says, in one accord. You know, we're not talking Honda. Right? But one accord. Mind, heart, soul, spirits, the word wise, and we're heading that direction. Amen? You had your hand up.
Yeah, you talked about the non-denomination, like Calvary Chapel, distinctive or non-denominational. What is the difference between a denomination and a Calvary, which is not denomination? What can you say about what's a denomination?
Well, you'll have a denomination, for example, you know, okay, most of you know that my first pastoral responsibility was at a denominational church. The Southern Baptists. And so Southern Baptists have their bylaws that are distinct from the non-denominational, specifically Calvary distinctives, in the sense that Southern Baptist is congregational. And so they base it on that there's the pastor, but ultimately the congregation has a say in the matters of the direction of the church. For example, this is for an example. Let's say hypothetically that we're going to, you know, buy the parking lot across the street, okay? And in the current status of where we're at as far as non-denominational, according to Calvary Distinctives, we would have a meeting with the board members because it would pass the threshold of what we're allowed to spend, okay? And we would have a meeting with the board members to give a presentation of why we believe that God is leading us to purchase this parking lot, okay? And then the board members, then they would have that ultimate say as far as, you know, vetting it, whether we have finances, whether it's, you know, lining up biblically, and ultimately if everybody has the peace of the Lord, you know? And so that decision would be made on the board members and involving the elders. With a Southern Baptist denomination, it would be presented to the church, the congregation. All those details would be given out, and then on a specified meeting date, then every church member that meets the criteria to be a church member would then have an equal vote as to whether we're buying that church parking lot or not. And again, this is just an example. And so then it goes majority rules generally, or there's a threshold as to what would a majority be. You know, they may have it set up to where it has to be 70%, or 51 is a majority, 51% is a majority. And so the problem with that is that first and foremost, like I said, let's say 51% of the church isn't walking with the Lord, and they have carnal reasons why they want to do or not do, you know. Let's say, for instance, whatever the case may be, they're not happy with the fact that the pastor's teaching from Timothy. And to teach the pastor a lesson, so to speak, they're going to say, well, let's all get together, and we're going to say thumbs down. And see, now you're potentially quenching the spirit. And you have to be very careful of that. You know? But that applies to anything that we do in our lives as Christians. You know? The decisions that we make as Christians, period, should never be based on my flesh. My flesh needs to die. You know? It has to be set aside. And it has to be the Lord. And it has to be, again, based on His Word, on His leading. And when we do those things, when we truly seek the Lord with a pure heart, He'll lead us, as He pointed out in Proverbs 3, He'll lead us in the ways of everlasting, His ways. And so that's kind of one example of denominational. And, you know, and in our country, and just basically in Christendom, period, there's a plethora of denominations. And basically what happens is this, is denominations generally are birthed by a split that says, we're not happy with this one point within your denomination, so we're going to split, start a separate denomination, and then tack on what we like. And then you see, and then all of a sudden, the more you do that, the further you deviate from the original, the truth, God's way. You know, I equate it to this, in this manner. You know, if you're on an island, and all of a sudden the Bible is dropped onto that island, that's all you need. That is all you need. That is all you need to start, you know, serving the Lord, to know God first and foremost, and then to start serving Him. That is all you need. But unfortunately, people have deviated and said, well, we're going to add to that, you know, and for whatever the reasons may be. For self-preservation, for, you know, the furtherance of personal agendas, or for, you know, through whatever the reasons may be, even through ignorance, thinking that, you know what, this is what God meant, and so, you know, we're going to deviate going this way, kind of like helping God out. And He don't need our help. Yeah. He does not need our help. He just needs us to obey. So, any other questions? No? All right. Let's just pray up. Father, we thank you and praise you so much that you've given us your word, that all we have to do is just obey. Just trust and obey. You've given us examples of successful ones and also true examples of when we disobey, how horribly it goes wrong. And we just want to, Lord God, glorify your name. This, as we heard today, and we know this to be true, that the church belongs to you. It's made up of individuals, individual parts of the body that come together and to love you and to serve you. But ultimately, you're the head of the church. We're to seek you to the guiding of what we're to do or not to do. Help us to never get ahead of you. I pray that we would never, Lord God, deviate from what you teach us, what you pour into our hearts. And Lord, the purpose of these teachings, these next couple Sundays, is not to cast any stones on any of our brothers and sisters, but just to clarify what we believe here, this fellowship, the guiding principles, our convictions, and what we see according to your word. We do pray for the entirety of the church to be one body, to love one another as you've commanded us to do, that the world would know that we belong to you by the way that we love one another, that we can see past the differences that should not separate us, but that, Lord God, that we would stand firm and fast in those that are non-negotiable. You are the Lord. You are God. You came to this earth to die for the sins of the world. You rose again on that third day, and you live. You were, you are, and you will always be. You never change. Thank you for revealing yourself to us and filling our hearts with your love and your peace. We ask now that you just bless this last song of worship, and that as we depart to our separate ways, that you would carry your light in our hearts and be that light in the world, Lord God. Be salt. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's heard and said, amen.